Good morning, everyone, and thank you for joining us. I am pleased to announce our financial results for the first half of fiscal 22. We're off to a great start, building on our strong momentum in fiscal 21, while continuing to execute against our strategic objectives. I will begin with an overview of our first half performance before Lavanya reviews our financial results in more detail. I will wrap up with why we are confident in our ability to deliver sustainable long-term growth. We delivered a strong performance in the first half while navigating a very dynamic environment. I would like to take this opportunity to thank my Diageo colleagues for their continued hard work, resilience, and creativity. I'm immensely proud of our culture, our values, and our people. There are five key areas I want to highlight from our first half performance. One, we delivered strong results across all key financial metrics. Two, our advantage portfolio and core capabilities enabled sustained market share gains. Three, we invested in marketing, innovation, and CapEx with a long-term view. Four, we continued to do business the right way for all our stakeholders. And five, we continued our strong track record of creating value for shareholders. We performed strongly across all key financial metrics in the first half of fiscal 22 while continuing to invest for the long term. We delivered strong top-line organic growth of 20% and significantly improved our organic operating margin in a challenging operating environment. Strong cash flow generation is enabling us to reinvest in long-term growth, including our production capacity, digital capabilities, and our sustainability agenda. And we're pleased to announce a 5% increase in our interim dividend. This performance shows how our profitable growth model is delivering results. Our strong top-line growth, gross margin expansion, and productivity savings have enabled consistent reinvestment in our brands and strategic growth initiatives. We delivered strong organic net sales growth across all regions, and I'm delighted that organic net sales in the first half exceeded the first half of fiscal 19 in all five regions. This strong performance across both developed and emerging markets demonstrates the resilience of our business despite continued challenges from the pandemic. We also saw significant growth across key categories, with tequila growing 56%, scotch up 27%, and our beer business growing 22%, driven by Guinness in Ireland, Great Britain, and Africa. This reinforces the strength of our portfolio across geographies, categories, and price tiers. During the half, we benefited from the recovery in the on-trade channel in several markets, particularly Great Britain, Southern Europe, Ireland, and the US. Across regions, we also performed strongly in the off-trade channel, where consumer demand remained resilient. Winning quality market share is a key focus. Our advantage portfolio across price segments, categories, and geographies has enabled continued market share gains. This has been driven by superior consumer insights, strong commercial execution, upweighted marketing investment, and accelerated innovation as we continue to respond to emerging opportunities. We believe these capabilities are a sustainable competitive advantage as we continue to invest behind them. Lavanya will provide further insight into these capabilities, for example, how we are using demand radar to enhance our commercial execution. In the first half of fiscal 22, we grew or held our off-trade share for over 85% of total net sales in measured markets. Diageo is also gaining share of TBA in the on-trade channel as it continues to recover, including in the US, Europe, and East Africa during the first half. I'm delighted with what we have achieved over the half, gaining share of Scotch in North America being one of the many highlights, and I'm excited about the opportunities ahead. Our core capabilities, which we discussed at our recent Capital Markets Day, fueled our strong performance in the first half of fiscal 22. Our world-class brand building is fundamental to driving our business, and it's delivering great performance. I'm delighted with the growth of our global brands, in particular Johnnie Walker, which grew 31%, supported by a robust performance by Johnnie Walker Black Label, and even faster growth in the more premium variants. And I'm very pleased with the recovery of Guinness sales, which were up 27%. I want to highlight our brand building capability with Tanqueray, one of our most iconic brands. During the first half of fiscal 22, we increased marketing investment, specifically behind the unmistakably Tanqueray campaign. We leveraged innovation to recruit new consumers, including ready-to-drink formats, flavored gins such as Tanqueray Blackcurrant Royale, and a no-alcohol option in Tanqueray 0.0. And we engaged in culture-leading brand partnerships with House of Gucci on Tanqueray and Stanley Tucci on Tanqueray No. 10. In the first half of fiscal 22, the Tanqueray brand grew 28%, with Tanqueray No. 10 growing 33%, gaining category share across several key markets. I believe our supply chain has proven to be a continued competitive advantage and has allowed us to navigate the volatility in the current challenging operating environment. We've been able to use our scale and operational excellence to mitigate the majority of supply disruptions which are impacting the consumer goods sector, and we have strong relationships with key suppliers. For example, navigating port congestion has been helped by our relationships and agreements with global shipping lines, as well as having advantaged access to local ports. Diageo is an organization that's obsessed with our brands and consumers. We're delivering strong performance and growth, but with a restlessness to always do better. Our people and unique purpose-driven culture are driving performance. We are investing to deliver our 10-year sustainability action plan, and we are making progress against our goals to promote positive drinking, champion inclusion and diversity, and pioneer grain-to-glass sustainability. As part of our commitment to reach 1 billion people with dedicated responsible drinking messaging by 2030, we launched a global responsible drinking campaign during the recent festive period, Know When to Stop. It was designed to make people stop and think about overindulgence. We also continued the rollout of Wrong Side of the Road, our hard-hitting digital experience to change attitudes to the dangers of drinking and driving, which is now live in 12 countries. This past September marked Diageo's fifth annual Inc. Week, a grassroots event created and executed by our employee resource groups and their allies. With representatives from over 20 countries and markets, the event focused on a broad range of topics, from disability and mental health to allyship and belonging. In the first half of fiscal 22, our hiring into leadership roles was 41% female and 53% ethnically diverse across external hires and internal promotions. In the current competitive environment, this highlights how the attractiveness of the Diageo employer brand is enabling us to hire, grow, and retain the best and most diverse talent. During the half, we achieved a number of significant milestones towards our sustainability goals. We opened the new carbon-neutral Bulleit whiskey distillery in the US. We broke ground on our Chinese whiskey distillery, which will also be carbon neutral. And we announced that we're jointly investing with the provincial government of Quebec to make our Valleyfield distillery carbon neutral by 2025. Also, Don Julio Tequila became the first brand to receive the environmentally responsible agave certification from the Tequila Regulatory Council and the government of the state of Jalisco in Mexico. I'm also very proud of the level of external recognition that Diageo and its employees have received for environmental, societal, and governance achievements over the last 6 months, including being ranked in the Dow Jones World Sustainability Index for the fourth year in a row, and validation of our 2030 greenhouse gas emission targets by the Science Based Targets Initiative. We have a strong track record of creating value for shareholders. We've increased our full-year dividend per share every year for over 20 years. We're continuing to execute our return of capital program through share buybacks, and we're accelerating the completion of our current program, which we now expect to complete during fiscal 23. At December 2021, we had completed £1.9 billion of our program of up to £4.5 billion. Our 10-year annualized total shareholder return to 31st December 2021 is in the top quartile of our peer group. Overall, we delivered a strong performance in the first half of fiscal 22 while still investing in long-term growth and value creation. This was enabled by our advantage portfolio and core capabilities. Now, I will hand over to Lavanya to take you through more of the detail on our financial results.
Thank you, Ivan, and good morning, everyone. As Ivan shared, we delivered a strong set of results in the first half of fiscal 22. This demonstrates our effective brand building, excellent commercial execution, and supply chain excellence. Organic net sales grew 20%, with volume growth of 9% and positive price mix of 11%. Growth was driven by the recovery of the on-trade and resilient consumer demand in the off-trade, where we continued to gain market share. And it was underpinned by favorable industry trends of premiumization and spirits taking share of total beverage alcohol. Organic operating margin expanded 131 basis points. Growth in operating profit generated strong free cash flow of £1.6 billion. Pre-exceptional earnings per share increased 22.5%, driven by growth in operating profit, partially offset by higher taxation and an adverse foreign exchange impact. Basic EPS increased 25% as we benefited from lower exceptional items. We increased our interim dividend by 5%, reflecting our progressive dividend policy and continued strong performance. Return on invested capital was 19.3%, up 352 basis points, mainly as a result of organic operating profit growth and partially offset by higher tax. Total shareholder return for the first half was 18%, reflecting the increase in our share price over the last 6 months and supported by our fiscal 21 final dividend. At our recent Capital Markets Day, I set out our profitable growth algorithm. And today, I will demonstrate how this delivered sustainable leverage growth in the first half of fiscal 22. Organic net sales grew 20% and positive price mix contributed over half of that growth. Positive mix reflected strong growth of our premium plus brands and the continued recovery of the on-trade channel in North America, Europe, and the partial recovery of travel retail. We increased prices across regions, and particularly in Latin America and Caribbean, Africa and North America. We combined this strong top-line performance with a continued focus on productivity and delivered £190 million of savings in the half across COGS, marketing, and overheads. This enabled reinvestment in sustainable long-term growth drivers, including a 27% increase in our marketing investment ahead of net sales growth. Consistent, effective investment in our brands has been a key driver of our market share gains. I'll now discuss each of these elements of our growth algorithm in more detail. We delivered double-digit organic net sales growth across all five regions. Our three-year CAGR of net sales in the first half was 8%. North America grew 13%, driven by the on-trade recovery, resilient consumer demand in the off-trade, and market share gains. We also benefited from the favorable industry trend of premiumization and spirits taking share of total beverage alcohol. Europe grew 27%, reflecting the recovery of the on-trade, particularly in Great Britain, Southern Europe, and Ireland. Off-trade demand remained resilient, and we continued to gain market share. Asia-Pacific grew 13%, primarily due to strong growth in Greater China and India. Net sales continued to recover across the rest of Asia-Pacific, although performance was impacted by on-trade restrictions and reduced tourism. Africa grew 23% with growth across all markets, particularly Nigeria and East Africa. Latin America and Caribbean grew 45% with strong double-digit growth across all markets. Growth reflects the recovery of the on-trade and resilient consumer demand in the off-trade, where we continued to gain market share. Strong growth of premium plus scotch drove positive mix, and we increased prices across key markets. At Capital Markets Day, we laid out our key strategic categories, and we delivered broad-based growth across each of these in the half. Scotch grew 27% and drove around one-third of Diageo's net sales growth. All regions contributed to the strong performance, and we benefited from the partial recovery of travel retail. Johnnie Walker grew 31% ahead of Scotch, with particularly strong growth of Johnnie Walker Black Label and Super Deluxe variants. The three-year volume CAGR for Scotch of 4% demonstrates the resilience of the category and our ability to grow our broad, deep portfolio of blended whiskey and single malts through world-class brand building. Other international whiskey grew 6%. Supply constraints impacted the growth of Crown Royal and led to a decline in bullet sales in North America. The strong performance in gin was driven by growth across Europe, Africa, and Latin America and Caribbean. Tanqueray and Gordon's both grew double digits. Tequila was 9% of Diageo's net sales. The 56% growth reflects the strong performance of Casamigos and Don Julio in the US, where both brands gained significant share of the US spirits market and the tequila category. Beer grew 22% and Guinness was up 27%, with strong growth in Ireland, Great Britain, and Africa as the on-trade continued to recover. Chinese white spirits maintained its strong growth momentum, with sales up 26%, underpinned by upweighted investment in this key strategic growth market. As in previous years, our premium plus brands were a significant driver of performance, contributing 74% of organic net sales growth in the half. Our super premium plus brands grew 31% and contributed over 35% of Diageo's organic net sales growth. In particular, our super premium plus tequila portfolio grew very strongly and ahead of the tequila category growth in the US. This reflects our effective marketing and successful innovation, including the launch of luxury variants, Don Julio Primavera and Don Julio Ultima Reserva. We also delivered strong growth of super premium plus scotch across all regions. In particular, the higher marks of Johnnie Walker grew strongly, supported by the launch of our fresh and modern Keep Walking campaign, which we shared with you at our Capital Markets Day. Our premium portfolio grew 27%, primarily driven by the strong performance of premium scotch across all regions, and in particular, Latin America and Caribbean, due to excellent commercial execution and effective marketing. Premium beer grew 31%, reflecting the strong performance of Guinness in Europe and Africa. The value and standard segments of our portfolio grew at a lower rate than the group. A strong performance in Scotch, driven by Johnnie Walker Red Label, was partially offset by declines in Captain Morgan and Smirnoff in the US. Bailey's also declined in the US due to lapping a strong comparator. As I shared earlier, a strong price mix improvement strengthened our top-line growth and drove margin expansion in the half. In response to increased inflation across the supply chain, and supported by strong marketing investment, we increased prices through the half that balanced both margin and share growth. We take a rigorous approach to pricing decisions, which are targeted based on our consumer insights, market understanding, and commercial strategy. I'll share a couple of examples with you. In the US, we increased prices by an average of just over 4.5% across Casamigos and Don Julio in the half. We continued to see strong volume growth for both brands, despite supply constraints on certain aged variants. And both brands have continued to grow share. Our tequila portfolio drove a 90 basis point increase in our share of the US spirits market during the half. And we increased our share of tequila category by almost 450 basis points. We also increased prices across emerging markets, including Nigeria and Turkey, where we are exposed to a significant foreign exchange devaluation and high inflation. In Nigeria, we delivered average price growth of 30% across all key categories. At the same time, we delivered 13% volume growth in the half and grew share. In Europe, where the pricing environment has historically been challenging, we use our full suite of revenue growth management levers to grow margin. For example, in one of our key markets in Europe, we successfully prioritized our on-trade customers based on their growth potential, which enabled us to optimize trade spend. This delivered an improvement in NSV per case across SKUs, and we gained over 20 basis points of market share in the first half of fiscal 22. We upweighted marketing investment across regions in the half, particularly North America, Europe, and Latin America and Caribbean. Our reinvestment rate increased to 17%. This was a key enabler to growing or holding our off-trade market share in 85% of total net sales value in measured markets. As we shared at our Capital Markets Day, we use proprietary tools and data analytics to determine how and where we deploy our marketing. Demand Radar, a tool we launched in fiscal 20, enables us to forecast consumer demand at a more granular level through a combination of monthly and daily inputs. It uses macroeconomic indicators and open source data such as Google footfall and the Oxford COVID-19 stringency index to track changes in consumer mobility. It enables us to right-size our marketing investment to the opportunity based on real-time market conditions. This is an advantage, particularly in volatile environments, such as during the height of the pandemic. Demand Radar now covers 80% of our A&P spend in 50 countries, representing 85% of our net sales value. I will share a couple of recent examples that show the benefit this tool is delivering. In Colombia, we used Demand Radar to identify the key occasions when consumers purchased local spirits. This enabled us to invest confidently and drove continued market share growth. In Southern Europe, Demand Radar showed us that the key growth opportunities were daytime occasions and within premium plus price tiers. Our focused activation underpinned our share gains in the half. When we announced our fiscal 21 results, I shared that we were seeing increased inflation driven by commodities, energy costs, and supply disruptions. We have five key levers to help mitigate inflation: volume leverage as we grow the business, continued premiumization, our revenue growth management capabilities, our productivity initiatives, and the natural hedge provided by our aged liquids. There's also a tailwind from the continued recovery of the on-trade channel and travel retail. We delivered around £190 million of productivity savings in the half, which partially offset the impact of cost inflation. The biggest drivers of cost savings were COGS productivity and marketing effectiveness. For example, we changed our sourcing strategy for tequila in Mexico to reduce the cost of our tequila liquid purchases. We also improved our process controls for filling and blending tequila, which will reduce liquid waste and drive efficiencies. To increase marketing effectiveness, we have implemented a new process to manage the storage and ordering of point-of-sale inventory in Europe and Latin America and Caribbean. This enabled us to remove unused inventory from our warehouses and reuse and repurpose where it was possible. This has reduced both waste and warehouse costs. The new process has improved the visibility of our point of sale inventory and will optimize our demand planning in the future. It also enables us to work with our suppliers to help deliver our Scope 3 ambition by 2030. We will roll the process out to other regions in fiscal 23. Reported operating profit increased 22.5% and operating margin, excluding exceptional items, expanded by 165 basis points. This was driven by strong organic growth of 24.7%, with growth across all regions, and organic operating margins improved by 131 basis points. Organic operating profit growth was partially offset by an unfavorable impact from foreign exchange rate movements. We delivered a significant improvement in operating margin, driven by a strong recovery in gross margin and operating leverage, while increasing our marketing investment. Gross margin increased by 147 basis points, primarily driven by positive mix and improved fixed cost absorption from volume growth. Supply productivity savings and price increases more than offset the impact of cost inflation. As we shared at our Capital Markets Day, we act like owners in our long-term investment decisions. There were some great examples during the half. As well as supporting our brands with strong marketing investment, we launched new consumer experiences, which is another key element of our brand building. We were very excited to open the doors of Johnny Walker Princess Street in September. And we broke ground on a Guinness tap room in Chicago, which will open in 2023. We continued to invest in our core capabilities, including digital tools. One of these was Diageo One, our proprietary B2B platform, which is now live in 6 countries. In the first half alone, over 30,000 customers registered and placed orders in the system. We also invested in production capacity and the delivery of our 10-year sustainability plan. Ivan already touched on a number of the sustainability milestones that we achieved in the half as we build capacity to deliver our strategic growth objectives. I also want to highlight the $500 million investment we are making to expand our manufacturing footprint in Mexico, which will support growth in the tequila category. We delivered 1.6 billion pounds of free cash flow. This was 17% ahead of free cash flow in the first half of fiscal 19, as we benefited from our everyday focus on cash, which is embedded in our business rhythm. Cash delivery in the first half of fiscal 22 was slightly lower than in the first half of fiscal 21, primarily due to lapping an exceptionally strong working capital benefit. This resulted from a significant increase in creditors as the operating performance recovered during the first half of fiscal 21, following reduced volumes and cost control measures in the second half of fiscal 20. I expect fiscal 22 to follow our normal cycle, with a buildup of net working capital in the first half, then reversing in the second half. Debtor balances reduced slightly in the half as they returned to more normalized levels, having expanded as the business picked up in the first half of fiscal 21. Our focus on debtor risk management and collections resulted in our days sales outstanding being over 5 days lower than at the end of the first half of fiscal 19, and our overdue balances are at a historically low level. Inventory balances increased to support business growth and mitigate the impact of supply chain disruptions. CapEx increased in the first half of fiscal 22 as we restarted construction projects that were delayed due to COVID-19. For the full year, I now expect CapEx to be in the range of £950 million to £1 billion, up from £626 million in fiscal 21. This reflects an increased investment behind our strategic priorities, including projects that were delayed in fiscal 21. The increase in cash tax payments in the half primarily reflected the improved business performance. The negative cash flow impact from other items was due to lapping a payment of £82 million from Moët Hennessy, which was received in the first half of fiscal 21, but related to the financial year ended December 2019. Our leverage ratio of 2.5 times at December 2021 was at the low end of our target range, and it was 0.9 times lower year-on-year as a result of our strong performance. Strong free cash flow delivery drove a year-on-year reduction of £0.3 billion in our closing net debt and a reduction of £0.8 billion in our average net debt. Our net interest charge decreased by £24 million compared to the first half of fiscal 21, primarily due to lower average debt. It was also due to lapping higher costs in the first half of fiscal 21, which related to our actions to increase liquidity at the outset of COVID-19. For the same reasons, our effective interest rate decreased by 0.2% to 2.6% in the half. For the full year, I expect our effective interest rate to be within the range of 2.7% to 3%. We remain committed to a leverage ratio of 2.5 times to 3 times adjusted net debt to EBITDA. We have a consistent and disciplined approach to capital allocation. Our priority is to invest in the business to drive sustainable organic growth and to acquire strategic brands that strengthen our exposure to fast-growing categories and occasions. Today, we announced an interim dividend of 29.36 pence per share, a 5% increase on our interim dividend in fiscal 21. This is in line with the growth rate of our final dividend in fiscal 21. Our dividend cover strengthened to 1.8 times in the first half of fiscal 22 and was back within our target range of 1.8 times to 2.2 times. Looking forward, we expect to maintain mid-single-digit dividend growth as we build dividend cover to be comfortably within our range. When we have excess cash, we seek to return it to shareholders. Our current return of capital program will return up to £4.5 billion. We completed the first phase of £1.25 billion in fiscal 20, and in May 2021, we commenced the second phase to buy back shares of up to £1 billion in value by the end of fiscal 22. We have completed £0.6 billion of share buybacks in the second phase to date, of which £0.5 billion was completed during the first half of fiscal 22. We expect to complete this phase of the program by no later than 4th of March 2022. We are accelerating the timeline of our return of capital program, and we now expect to complete the return of up to £4.5 billion during fiscal 23. We will announce the next phase in due course. An unfavorable foreign exchange movement significantly impacted both net sales and operating profit in the first half of fiscal 22. This was driven by sterling strengthening against the US dollar and emerging market currencies. We are not able to provide specific guidance for foreign exchange in relation to fiscal 22. If we applied exchange rate of £1 to $1.36 and £1 to €1.2, we would expect a negative impact on net sales and operating profit in the second half of fiscal 22. However, we would expect the impact to be significantly lower than in the first half of fiscal 22. Earnings per share before exceptional items increased 22.5% from 69.9 pence to 85.6 pence. This was primarily driven by organic operating profit growth, partially offset by higher taxation and an unfavorable foreign exchange impact. Our tax charge increased, mainly due to the increase in taxable profits and tax rate increases in certain markets. Our tax rate before exceptional items was 23%, in line with our full-year guidance for fiscal 22 to be within a range of 22% to 24%. The improved performance of our listed subsidiaries increased our non-controlling interest deduction to EPS. Share buybacks reduced the weighted average number of shares, generating a positive impact on EPS. Looking forward, we expect organic net sales momentum to continue through the second half of fiscal 22, although we are lapping a tougher comparator. we believe we are well positioned to benefit from resilience in the off-trade and continued recovery in the on-trade. However, we expect near-term volatility to remain, including potential impacts from COVID-19 and global supply chain constraints, and for disruption in travel retail to continue. In North America, we expect consumer demand to remain resilient, although we are lapping a tougher comparator. We will continue to invest ahead in marketing and innovation to underpin growth in our well-positioned portfolio. In Europe, we expect to benefit from continued recovery in the on-trade to the extent that restrictions ease. We expect the off-trade channel to remain resilient. In Asia, Pacific, Africa, and Latin America and Caribbean, we will continue to build on the momentum in the first half, recognizing that disruption related to COVID-19 will likely persist in these markets. During the second half of fiscal 22, we expect organic operating profit to grow ahead of organic net sales. We expect organic operating margin to benefit from growth in sales volume, favorable channel mix, and premiumization trends, while we continue to invest in our marketing and commercial capabilities, particularly in North America and China. We expect our focus on everyday efficiency and revenue growth management to help mitigate the impact of cost inflation. We are very encouraged by our strong performance in the first half of fiscal 22 in a volatile environment. Our advantaged portfolio and geographic footprint are driving strong top-line growth. The strong growth combined with positive price mix and productivity savings is enabling us to expand margins despite cost inflation. We are investing in long-term growth and creating value for shareholders. We will continue to navigate the near-term disruptions and cost pressures, and we remain confident in the medium-term outlook. For fiscal 23 to 25, we expect organic net sales to consistently grow within a range of 5% to 7%, and we expect organic operating profit to sustainably grow within a range of 6% to 9%. With that, I'll hand back to you, Ivan.
Thank you, Lavanya. As we set out at our recent Capital Markets Day, we have a bold ambition to increase our share of total beverage alcohol, or TBA, by 50%, from 4% to 6% by 2030. TBA is an attractive market which is large and growing. With about a 4% value share of TBA currently, there is significant headroom for long-term sustainable growth. Our ambition is to deploy our strong competitive advantage to outperform the market. Overall, I'm very pleased with the strength and quality of these financial results, and we continue to execute strongly against our strategic priorities despite the near-term volatility. I'm very excited and optimistic about our growth opportunities. Spirits is rapidly premiumizing and taking share of TBA. And our iconic global brand, Guinness, is well positioned for the key growth trends within the beer category as a premium, flavorful, and differentiated beer. Diageo has an advantage portfolio across price segments, categories, and geographies. Our capabilities, people, and culture are a sustainable competitive advantage. We have used our brand building and supply chain capabilities particularly effectively through a challenging period. We invest for the long term, and we are actively shaping our portfolio through innovation and strategic M&A. And we have a strong track record in ESG and an ambitious commitment to positively impact society. We remain confident in our strategy and ability to continue delivering sustainable long-term growth and shareholder value. Thank you.